Okay, thank you. So first of all, thanks all of you for setting up with this workshop within this consortium. It's a very nice opportunity to discuss and to collaborate all together. So this is really a great initiative, and thank you for that. So I decided to focus really on what we do, which is specific to non-Gaussians. I apologize a little bit for people in Olomouc that heard something quite similar 2 weeks ago or something like that. We didn't do a new experiment in the last 2 weeks, so I'm sorry for that, but I will show you, try to go a bit into details and get a bit of perspective. I will start this by doing a quick review of what I will talk about, a bit of if I can change my slide, sorry, a bit of a summary of our experiment, and then I will come back to the details, and obviously you're welcome to ask questions even on the way. So the story of this, I will tell you, started a few years ago, nearly 10 years ago, and the first good results we got was 2014, somehow, is when we started to do a multimode state in the continuous variable regime with optical frequency control. And so why did we start to work in such a regime? It's because, as you know, if you take optical frequency combs, if you look in the frequency domain, they are made of many frequencies, so which is many degrees of freedom. And if you look in the time domain, you have optical pulses. Optical pulse is nice because it has a high intensity, and thus you can hope to generate multiple pairs of photons using a nonlinear effect because of its power issue. And if you do so, just my slide again, sorry. This is the way you can see the kind of states you could hope to generate, and this is what I will try to demonstrate in the rest of the talks, is that you have many frequencies, and each of the frequency is a quantum harmonic oscillator. And if you use parametric down conversion to populate these many frequencies, you will generate a very general, let's say, Gaussian states, which is why you have these Wigner functions, out of all these frequencies. So you get a very large entangled state. At least that was the hope at the origin. And then, as we have heard today, this is Gaussian statistics, so this is not enough to do a quantum computer. We are still far from that, but to do something that cannot be simulated with a classical computer. So still some work to do there. And this will be really the focus of my talk today, beyond explaining how we do this large Gaussian state. We will try from this Gaussian state to go directly to a multimode non-Gaussian state. So, this is something. I still have this review here. We heard about that this morning. So this is, and anyway, the small review I did here is not exhaustive, but just to give a hint, which you know already, of the different methods. But somehow you can think that some part of the community tries to generate directly a non-Gaussian state in a deterministic way. So this is really the point of single photon sources. You know that a single photon is kind of the best non-Gaussian optical source. Then you can try also to do directly a GKP state, for instance, in trapped ion, or, and I will come back to that just after, try to deterministically do a cubic phase gate, and this was something which was proposed here in Olomouc, for instance, but which are quite challenging experimentally. So as you all know, in optics, we have the second option is to do probabilistic methods. The most common is to herald a single photon out of a parametric down conversion. This is to work in the DV discrete variable regime. However, in our field, continuous variables, what people would do is a probabilistic degaussification, let's say, of Gaussian states by removing a single photon, very similar to what Julien also was talking about. This was what was done in the group of Philippe Grangier, for instance, and through this kind of schemes, go to more complex photon subtractions or multimode photon subtraction or photon manipulations on a Gaussian state to do a GKP state or cubic gate and so on. What I will be interested in this talk is to extend the single photon subtraction process to the multimode scenario. And so this is a summary of the total experiment I will speak about today and with the list of points I'd like to address. So what we do in our experiments, we generate multimode Gaussian states. Then we will implement mode dependent, so this goes beyond simply the beam splitter, so mode dependent photon subtractions to control a network of non-Gaussian states. So I will speak about a very limited size networks, and if you want to go to larger size, you will follow the talk of Valentina a little bit later today. And then, I will go through these things. I will try also to study a bit how non-Gaussian spreads when you have a cluster state, for instance. But let me go back in time a little bit and start to remind you or to give you some details on how we generate time frequency squeeze mode, which is the resource then for our system. Well, as I told you already, and maybe I will specify a bit more, we use an optical frequency comb. And here the numbers are important. So we have about 100 femtosecond pulses. We have two experiments. I will focus on the one when we have about 100 femtosecond pulses with 100 megahertz repetition rate. And this is very interesting. You know that optical frequency comb, you can have. So now we choose 100 megahertz repetition rate. It was easy for our experiment, but this give you a natural clock rate somehow at which you can hope to do experiment. And then you have a broadband light. So here it's 800 nanometer central wavelength with a 10 nanometer width. And this gives you about 10 to the 5 and 10 to the 6 longitudinal waves. So this can be used both for quantum metrology and quantum informations. So in our group, we also spent some time doing a quantum metrology, and also with Radima in particular, we try to think how can a non-Gaussian state be applied to this kind of a quantum metrology. I won't speak about that today, it's a bit too preliminary, but that's also a research line to pursue. There's a lot of things to do there. I will focus mainly on the quantum information point of view. And first, let me try to do Gaussian state. So as I told you, the way to generate Gaussian states, non-classical Gaussian states, obviously, is to use parametric down conversion. So the good old one, when you have a single photons at a given wavelength, the blue in our case, that splits into two photons. So I guess you all know, but it's interesting to give some details still. What does it mean generate two photons? Is that you have these two creation operators that corresponds to two frequency lines here. And you have a coupling matrix, which depends on the two experimental parameters you have. One, which is the pump amplitude. So it depends on the pump amplitude at the sum frequency, m plus n, and obviously on the crystal properties. And here, this is also a broad part of research, is how to optimize these two parameters to decide on the structure of the state you generate. In a nutshell, this is again the same slide as before, you generate pairs of photons that splits into many frequencies. You could wonder on why the frequencies remain discrete. The fact is, in our experiments, there's two ways to see, but in our experiment in particular, we will use a cavity that will set the available frequencies in your system. And before explaining it a bit more, I have that, so I think I would use, so which is a short movie of the experiment when you can see most elements. I will run it later, but here you see the laser source. So we did that for students that could not visit the lab because of the COVID situations, but then at least you can benefit from it too. So this is the laser source. This is where you prepare the light. In this plastics box, what is there is a cavity. I will show you just after. And all the rest, I guess, which is important in our experiment, and you see this, all this black box here are spatial light modulators. I will come back to that, but this is what we use to do pulse shaping, so to control the mode we will address in our experiment. And the big stuff over there is a multimode detection system. Okay, so let me move to the cavity itself, so which is in the box here. So this is how the cavity looks like. We have a 4 meter cavity, and this is what I told you before, huh, because you want a cavity with a, in an optics world, with a free spectral range matches exactly the different frequency line you have in your optical frequency group. In other words, the cavity lens corresponds to the 100 megahertz, it's exactly 76 megahertz repetition rate of our laser. So here you have the nonlinear crystal and the light that goes out of it here. So one of the advantages to use a pulse light, as I told you, is that you have high nonlinearity. So there's two things you can do. You can use very short crystal, which is important to have a low dispersion inside your cavity. And maybe more important, you can use a low finesse cavity, which means that losses inside of the cavity are not that important. Still, if we are there, one of the limitations of this work, which we are working on, is intra-cavity dispersions that come from air and mirrors and a bit of the crystal that limits the breadth of modes we can measure. So we have heard already of multimode light and large cluster states today. I want to precise a bit the vocabulary I will use. And using this slide, so this is not really mathematical, to set the notation and to really understand what we speak about, because as you have seen so far, our light is within only one beam. And how do you do multimode within one beam? Well, what you all know is that you have, if you take your frequency comb and you extract a single frequency, what you get is a plane wave, which you can see here, with the classical description of the function of the real and imaginary part of the two classical quadrature of your field. And this is where you get the usual Fresnel representation, so the phase space representation of your classical field. When you go quantum, when you go continuous variables, these two quantities do not commute, and you have, as I told you, a quantum harmonic oscillator for a single frequency. So now we have many frequencies. So what is a mode in our case? A mode is a given superposition of all these frequencies. So mathematically, it's a vector f of dimensions 2m if you start with m frequencies, and 2m encodes for both quadrature, the amplitude and phase of each frequency. And when you take a frequency comb, that you make a given superposition of all the available frequencies with a given amplitude and phase, what you are doing is pulse shaping. So what your mode is simply a pulse shape in time or in frequency. Which means that when I say we do a multimode measurement, it means in practice that we measure a given quadrature of a given mode. So if I take this mode F, I can measure amplitude quadrature of this mode F, which is given simply by the superposition of the X and P operators of all the individual frequencies with the weight corresponding to my vector F here. And as you see, when you do that, and this we will see quickly experimentally, we are able to do a pulse shaping to address this kind of modes. You have access to a very large number of modes experimentally. Let me stress for those who are not used, I told you that we have 10 to the 6 frequency in this kind of frequency gamma. Experimentally, this is not accessible resolution so far. And you will see we can address only much less modes right now. Anyway, so this is what we do. Now, when you allow yourself to measure in any modes, it means that you can write your Hamiltonian here in any mode, and the mode being a given superposition of the operator which are here. I wrote before a superposition of X and P in the quadrature space, but you can do the same in the creation operator space. So which means then that you can do your Hamiltonian is Hermitian. So nothing prevents you from finding a basis where your Hamiltonian is diagonal. So you move from a double sum to a single sum, where now your Hamiltonian corresponds to the creation of a pair of photons in eigenmodes of your systems. So this eigenmode, so here what you recognize is a sum of squeezing Hamiltonian. So sorry, each time the Hermitian conjugate are missing, this is just to make it simple. But this is a sum of independent squeezing Hamiltonian. So what you see is that parametering the conversion is nothing else than a sum of squeezers, but in a basis which is given by these operators that you can find by diagonalizing this matrix N. And if you do it for standard cases where so your pulse shapes are Gaussian and your phase matching function of your nonlinear question is close to Gaussian, what you find is that your eigenmodes are Gaussian function. Would it be in the frequency domain or in the time domain? And here they are represented in the time domain. And what this multimode Hamiltonian means, it means that when you generate two photons, these two photons will go in only one of these modes. So either in the first one, the second one, or the third one. So what your system consists in is a set of eigen pulse shapes, individually squeezed and non-correlated between each other. Well, I stress that because it means that in the same system, if you look in this basis of pulse shape, you see independent squeeze mode. But if you look in the basis of frequencies, what you have is correlations between photon numbers. So this is, for instance, a covariance matrix we have measured in the frequency domain. And sorry, each time I forgot to add to this figure the x and y axis. I'm sorry, but this corresponds to wavelengths. So what we have done here is that we split our frequency domain into 16 parts. And we measure the covariance matrix. So you have the correlation is diagonal. The noise of each frequency is in diagonal. And the correlations between two different frequencies of diagonal. So what you see here is that you have many correlations, while in this domain here, what you should have is many independent squeezers. So we don't have time for that here, but if you look in particular, this is a collaboration we got with Werner Vogel, looking at this kind of multimode state, and he could demonstrate that what you have is a really highly and completely multimode entangled state, which in whatever the partition you take of these states, you can prove entanglement. Okay, but then, sorry, let me go back one. Then this is to measure in the frequency domain to get your correlation. So what happens now if you want to measure in a proper basis? So would it be the eigenbasis or any of them? And this is the way we do. So we extend the usual homodyne detection using pulse shaping. So what you do is that you take your optical pulses and you shape exactly. So this corresponds exactly to the mathematical slide I've given you a few slides ago, because the experimental implementation. You spread your spectrum, you control amplitude and phase for each wavelength of your spectrum. This is about 600 pixels in a standard spatial light modulator. You bring them back together again, and you get a pulse which have a complicated shape. So this is a time frequency representation of your pulse that you interfere with the output of our OPO cavity. And this is a projective measurement. So what you can do with that is get the Wigner function of this mode that goes out of this cavity. Okay, so in a nutshell, to summarize this part, what we get, and I'll show everything, what we show in our experiment, and this is getting a bit old already, is that if you measure in the frequency domain, you can show that you have a 16 mode which are entangled. If you use pulse shaping to measure in this time frequency modes, what we could show that we have up to 12 squeeze modes with a limited squeezing. I will come back to that if you want. And then you can think, well, what do I have to measure either in the frequency domain or in the eigenmode domains? I can do measurements anywhere in between. And making measurements anywhere in between, this is really trying to generate a given shape of your correlations, because I remind you that in the Gaussian case, all correlations, and this is what is here, can be constructed from basis change on a set of squeezers. And with that, we have been doing cluster set. So this is what I've been presented by Ulrich this morning. So in our case, these are much more limited size cluster states in this train of pulses. But what is a bit different here, so what you see on top is the shape of cluster we could generate. What is different here is that we'd never change the source. So the source is given by this cavity. And in order to reveal this different shape of cluster states, and here below what you have is the corresponding nullifiers or inequalities that prove that you have this shape of cluster state on top. What we do is we change the measurement basis. So in practice, when you move from one graph to a different graph here, what you change is what is the meaning of these different dots which are here. And each dot corresponds to a given mode, and a mode corresponds to a given pulse shape. So in our case, when you change which pulse shapes makes your dots, you will reveal a different cluster state or a different graph state. As said, this is interesting because it's versatile. I will conclude on that. It's far from the size of the cluster state in the group of Akira or Ulrich or even the one of Olivier Pfister. And I will come back to that on my last slide. But in our group, what we decided to focus on is the application of this to quantum information. And this is also what Akira and Ulrich are doing. But in one point, which we think is important for quantum information, which is, as we have discussed already, when you generate states with parametric down conversions, your Wigner function is Gaussian. Thus, all the measurement statistics you will get are Gaussian if you use homodyne detections. And thus, this gives a limitation that you can see in two ways. Because everything is Gaussian, you have no hope because Gaussian Wigner function can be considered as a probability distribution. You have no hope to violate any Bell-like inequalities, at least with homodyne detections. And in another way, any Gaussian statistic can be simulated efficiently with a classical computer. So what you need is to go non-Gaussian. So you've heard about that with Julien this morning. So let me remind just quickly the concept as it was introduced by Philippe Grangier quite a while ago, which is that if you take a squeeze state and you remove a single photon, it's like applying the annihilation operator on the squeezing, and what you get is a non-Gaussian state. What is interesting is to think, I mean, in our case, of course, what is interesting, but in our case, is to consider what happens if you apply that to a multimode state. So if you take our multimode state, which is composed of many squeezers in different time modes, and you have a beam splitter, and you measure a single photon here. What is the issue here is that you have a superposition of many modes while your beam splitter here is completely mode independent. So it will treat all the modes the same way. There is no phase relation between them, which means that you don't know from which modes the photons come from. And this is really interesting to the way the beam splitter works, which means that what you will do is apply the annihilation operators as before to your squeeze states, but in a statistical superposition. So it could be a remove photon from the first mode or a remove photon from the second modes, and so on. So what I get is a mixed state of a photon subtracted squeeze state. But then this results in a mixed state, which is completely useless for quantum information. What we would like is to have a coherent superposition of photon removal. So then you will keep a pure state in that case. So this can be done this way. And this is, as many of you know already, this is something which is introduced in particular in the group of Christine Silberhorn, which is linked to some frequency generation. And this is really, nonlinear optics is a magic tool for any quantum optics experiment. So what we do in our case is not use a beam splitter anymore, but use some frequency process. So what you see, some frequencies that you take photons from what I call the signal beam, a photon from the gate beam, and you up convert in this way. So in this small animations, you generate a photon here, a blue photons. So if a blue photon goes into your detector here, you know that one and only one photon from your signal beam has been up converted. The beauty of this is, on the one hand, you know you have subtracted one photon from the signal, but on the second hand, your nonlinear effects, and this is where what was explained by Christine, are, and Benny in particular, mode dependent. So if I control the time frequency mode of my gate beam, I will control where I remove my photon signal from. So here, in this example, what I should get at the output is a state like that when I remove a photon. What I would like to do here is to comment a little bit before going directly in the quantum part on the classical part of this, because it's important to show how multimode this kind of things is. So I decided to explain you how we did characterize this system at the classical level. So why do I say at the classical level? Because if you look still at the quantum level, what happens here? So if you have a signal here and a gate and you remove a photon here, if you know nothing about your system, the only thing we know is that you have removed one and only one photon. This you know because you place yourself in the weak interaction regime. So you rely on the fact that the probability to remove two photons is low. Of course, this means that it's a low probability, but that's fine. So if you don't know where you remove your photon from, what you get is that the output density matrix is a sum of all possible subtraction in a given mode. So it doesn't have to be diagonal in the basis you consider. So what you have is that this chi matrix that tells you where you can remove this photon from, and it's a two-dimension matrix because you have a whole set of modes where you can remove a photon from. So if you want to characterize this matrix at the quantum level, it's quite hard. However, this is really an amplitude matrix. It's quite similar to when you do parametric down conversions. You can directly measure the coefficients here if for rho in here, you put current state. And if you put current state as rho in, what you will do is simply look at the probability, so the amplitude in blue, and that will give you the amplitude of this chi functions. So what we did experimentally is that we seed the signal here with many different modes. So here, what you see in this graph, this 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 7 modes there's only 6 in the drawn here, but that's fine, are the 6 different pulse shapes we put in the signal beam for a given gate beam. So here the gate shape is fixed to this one, and we put signal beam for these 6 of these 7 different pulse shapes and for superposition of this pulse shape, so to get the off-diagonal coefficients. But we do all that classically, and we simply measure what is the conversion efficiency for this kind of mode. And with that, you can reconstruct your chi matrix. And this is the result. So this is this chi matrix we measure in this Hermite-Gauss time frequency base. And what you see is that in our case, this matrix has only one element and is very pure. It means that indeed, classically, you will get up conversions if and only if your signal is in this pulse shape. And all the rest will not get converted. So this is really a tomography of your system. And then you can play by changing your gate beam. So we did, of course, all possibilities, but here I show you only a few. So I've shown you when I use the first Hermite-Gauss mode, the second Hermite-Gauss mode was for an example here. Now I use Hermite-Gauss mode number 6 here, so which starts to be highly oscillating. And you see we have a bit of crosstalks in this matrix, but it remains still very pure. So the quality of the photon subtraction, I didn't put the Schmidt number here, is something like less than 1.2, so it's still very good. We have a very good quality of photon subtraction. And you can do even more. You can, in your gate beam, you can use a complicated superposition of whatever pulse shapes. So we also decided to do a evenly weighted superposition of these five first pulse shapes. And what you see in that case is that your matrix corresponds exactly to what you expect. And calculating the Schmidt number, you will find it's very, very close to one. In that case, it's better than 1.1. And then you have what you show is that at the classical level, you have a nonlinear process which is highly mode dependent with a very, very good purity. And because it is a nonlinear effect and it's basically lossless. So I decided to include that in this presentation because it's good to show that this system is really highly multimode. It has a very good quality. And in the result, you will see nothing. Of course, it's experiment. It's not all perfect, but this system, this part here, is of a very good quality. So let me now show the complete experiment. So in the complete experiment, you have the TISAF laser that we go into the cavity, which I've shown you before. Then we have the nonlinear crystal to do the sum frequency and photon subtractions. And then we do a tomography of the state or the output for a given set of modes. Well, in practice, it looks like that. The first experiment you do is that you just do nothing. So you have your squeezing going through the nonlinear crystal. You don't do some frequency and you do tomography. And what you see is that you have a Wigner function. So I go quick on that, but just to remind you how these kind of things are done. And then we choose where we remove the photon from by putting here a given pulse shapes. We do the same tomography, so which are quadrature measurements as a function of the relative phase, so a function of the quadrature we look at. What you see is a typical I-shape system, and what you get is negative Wigner function in this first mode. So now if I can summarize in a way this kind of results. So I show the example on with three input modes, a bit simpler. So what I've shown you is that if we place the gate beam, so the reference beam in the first mode, you get negative Wigner function in the first mode. Well, then what you can do is to change this reference beam to remove a photon from the second mode. And these are all experimental results you have here. And these are the reconstructed Wigner functions. And what you see is that for mode one, you have indeed, again, a highly non-Gaussian state, and which is still negative. And then you can play around, as I told you before, by putting a superposition of modes here in your gate beam, because we know that our photon subtractor can handle multimode superposition. So here we put a superposition of these three modes, and you will notice with the I in between here. So as you see in this graph on the left, mode zero and mode two are squeezed in the same direction, while mode one is squeezed in the orthogonal direction. So if you place an I here, it means that you remove photons from a mode which is squeezed, because now you put the three of them squeezed in the same direction. So now we remove photons from a mode which is complicated, but which is squeezed. And if we do the tomography of this very same mode, what you see is again non-Gaussian Wigner function. I was hesitating, I'm not 100% sure it's a negative here for this superposition of modes. So in a nutshell, these are the kind of results we find, is that depending on which mode we choose, we can have one Wigner function, which is highly non-Gaussian and can reach negativity. Well, this is one part, which means that within a multimode scenario, we can get on-demand and well-controlled, not on-demand, but well-controlled negative Wigner functions. But what we are really interested in for further application is how you generate something which is multimode non-Gaussian, and in practice, how you can transfer and spread your non-Gaussianity. So in order to do so, we first looked at it theoretically. And just to give you a quick summary, I'm not gonna explain everything. What we did simulate and did calculate theoretically is what happens if you take a given cluster state. And I insist, the theory, of course, apply to any modes in a continuous variable scenario. For instance, what I've been presented by Ulrich, the same analysis can be applied exactly. So if you take a cluster state, for instance, here made of five modes, and you remove photons from this mode here, so originally your cluster is fully Gaussian, but if you remove photons from here, what you see is that the whole cluster becomes non-Gaussian. So those non-Gaussianities spread within the mode. What is interesting in this example, for instance, is that the single mode Wigner, none of them here is negative, but the Wigner function of the total state is negative. Then you see that the negativity spread among the modes. And what we could show is that the non-Gaussianity spreads two steps away. And because of the structure of cluster state, it is limited to two steps away. And to convince you of that, if you do that in a linear cluster, so this is a seven-mode linear cluster state, you see that you remove photons from the first mode, non-Gaussianity spread two steps away, but the remaining of the cluster is completely unchanged. It's exactly the same as before. If you remove a photon delocalized from two modes, which we can do, then everything which is two steps away from your two modes becomes affected, but the rest is completely the same as before. Another thing which is important here is that theoretically it's nice because we can calculate and draw a nice Wigner function. Experimentally, this is another story. What is the point is that you have two problems. Well, if you want to measure all these Wigner functions, it's a lot of measurement times. So this is one issue. But in fact, if you want really to reveal your full quantum state, you should also measure all the correlations. So you have to do a complete tomography of your quantum state. Obviously, when you have a Gaussian state and you want to do a complete tomography, it's simple because you can use the covariance matrix. So that's fine, you have a limited size measurement. However, when you're non-Gaussian, you have to measure all the moments. So to get exponential complexity as a function of the number of moments. So experimentally, it's not tractable anymore. So we need witnesses. There's a lot of work ongoing in this kind of witnesses. In this work here, we are doing something very simple, which I will explain just after. We just look at the kurtosis of our modes, which is not enough completely, but for what we wanted to do here was enough to reveal the quantum state. So just to show you what we have done experimentally. So now we move to experiments. We took a four-mode cluster state out of our system. We look at the kurtosis, as I just told you. So kurtosis is simply the first order moment, renormalized so that it is equal to zero for a Gaussian. And these are the experimental measurements we have before photon subtraction. And after photon subtraction, what you see is that it deviates a lot from the Gaussian case. And what is important is that we remove the photon from mode one, which is this one here. And what you see is that the kurtosis really changed from mode three. So what you have is a spread of or transfer of the non-Gaussianity from mode one to mode three in this case. And the other thing which is interesting is that you see that in blue now is what we calculate theoretically as a function of the covariance matrix we have. And what you see is that we have a very good agreement. And this corresponds to what I told you at the beginning, is that in our experiment, in fact, might be surprising, but what limits the quality of the result we get here is not the photon subtraction itself. So we have a very good mode dependent of subtraction, very low dark points and so on. So this works very well. What limits is the fact that the original covariance matrix is a bit noisy, meaning that the input state is not completely pure. And this is also mainly due to some technical effect like dispersion in the cavity. I'd be happy to discuss this point if you're interested. So we also, maybe there's no need to spend too much time on that. We also looked at a linear cluster, and we show a bit what I've shown you before by removing a photon in mode 4. Here we have negativity in mode 3. In a superposition of modes, we have negativity, sorry, non-Gaussianity in mode 4, and so on. So we can transfer this kind of non-Gaussianity. I would like to finish these presentations by giving you a bit of insight on what are indeed the exact conditions to induce Wegener negativity. So now, if you place yourself in a scenario, multimode scenario, and you want to use photon subtraction, for instance, to generate multimode Gaussian states and spread this non-Gaussianity and go to Wegener negativity, which is what you really need for quantum informations, what are the conditions? Well, the conditions are, as I told you, it's a multimode scenario, but in fact, you can write them only in the two-mode case. And if you consider this two-mode doesn't have to be pure, in fact, it applies to any two modes within a graph state. So the only thing I assume here is that this two-mode state is Gaussian to start with, but it doesn't have to be pure because it can be embedded in a large cluster state. And what I want here is to perform a measurement on operations on the left mode, which I call G, with a given operator, which is in particular a POVM element of a measurement operator. And given I measure this POVM, I want to know what is the state I generate here. So you will see the states here want to look like a GKP state, but we are very far from generating a GKP state here. This is just for illustration. What we get here is a conditional state. So we get the density operator of this state as a function of a measurement of A. So the questions we want to answer here is what are the properties of the conditional state Wegener functions, and what are the requirements on rho, in particular at the beginning, to induce Wegener negativity. So I spare you all the calculations, but I still decided to give a little bit of details, not too many. So we perform this calculation using the Wegener function formalism because it's a bit easier. So if you take the Wegener function of your complete state, what you have then is the Wegener function of your measurement operator as a function of the quadrature of mod G. So this is what this XG stands for. And then you have the Wegener function of your mod F upon measurement of A and as a function of the quadrature of X. And this you can show that this is simply equal to the mean value of A knowing XF, so it's like a conditional measurement of A, time the Wegener function of F itself, so times the reduced function of F. So what you have is this conditional Wegener function is in fact the original Wegener functions multiplied by the condition measurement mean value. And then, so this is just to give the notations. And then you look at how you can get nonlinearity and what you can extract. I didn't put back the reference, sorry, I forgot that, but this is a known result. So what is known is that the Wegener function in G knowing F, so this is your conditional Wegener functions, is a physical one. So it means it's not violate in Heisenberg inequality if and only if you don't have EPR steering between F and G. And this is for the Gaussian state. If and only this is valid because we start from Gaussian state. Well, if you accept this result, which is known in the literature, it's very interesting because the fact that the conditional Wegener function does not violate the Heisenberg inequality means that your conditional Wegener functions of XJ, of G mode, describe a quantum state. Thus, if you describe a quantum state, a physical one, it means that the mean value of any measurement operator, and in particular the one you're interested in, is positive. It's a proper measurement operator. So the measurement of A condition on the value of the measurement of XF if the original, if this one is a physical, it's positive. If this one is positive, it means that if your Wiener function, which is up there, this is, this term here is positive. Because your original Wiener function is a Gaussian state, is also positive, it means then you cannot have a Wigner-Nikodic-Witte. Okay, so here you see that there are a link directly between Einstein, Podolsky, Rosen, and so if you don't have any EPR steering, then you cannot generate Wigner negativity by making measurements in G. Okay, and this is boiling down to the fact that the conditioned Wigner function is a quantum state when you don't have EPR steering, which is, by the way, the definition of EPR steering. Just maybe I forgot to say, EPR steering is really when you do measurements, then you can violate in the Heisenberg inequality. So this we have generalized, and now I don't give any more detail. I just give you the results. So what we could prove, what I told you, is that EPR steering is a necessary resource. This is what I've just explained you. But more than that, EPR steering is a sufficient resource for conditional preparation of a Wigner negativity. But for that, you need to work a bit more. Photon subtraction EG is not enough. You have to introduce a slightly more general measurement operator, which is photon subtractions in between base exchange. So you have first to do a, not base exchange, you have first to do a Gaussian operation, so which can include some squeezing on G, and then do a single photon measurement. And if you allow yourself for this kind of measurements, then EPR steering is a necessary and sufficient condition to generate a Wigner negativity. So this is a very nice criteria because it tells you when you have a cluster state, when we have usually, which is Gaussian, where we know very well the covariance matrix, then we have a criteria that tells us if I make a non-Gaussian operation in that node, do I have any hope to generate Wigner negativity in other nodes? To finish on that presentation, and I'm nearly there, just to say one word about our experiment. So we didn't do all these possible measurements, but what we did was to check, do we have EPR steering in our experiment? So to do that, we, sorry, the representation is a bit different than before, but this is the optical spectrum of our multimode state in the Gaussian case. And what we do, we split it in four parts. And we look at, we have steering between two of these parts. And we even have done a bit more, is that we allowed ourselves that within each part to redivide in two or in four, and to do a basis change inside to optimize this steerability. And what you see is that depending on the number of partitions you allow yourself for, so the triangles is that when you don't do any subparts, and when you go to the square that you allow for two subparts and the circles to four subparts, what you see is that except for a small subset, most of the cases we have steering in our experiment, which means that in fact you have a very large opportunity to transfer Wigner negativity in our experiment, which, as I've shown you, is quite noisy and it's not completely pure, but still, it's a sufficient resource to have many possibilities of transferring negativity in our case. Well, it's time to conclude. I decided I will do not too long, but I want to say a few things on this last slide. So this is our experiment, as I've shown you before, and I want to comment a little bit on what we want to do next in this experiment. And there's quite a few things you can do. First, I told you one of the main limitations in our case is twofold, but is really linked to the Gaussian source, so to the cavity here. So one is the intra-cavity dispersion. So this we are working on it, just technical. Another one is we didn't put here, but it's is the spectral width of the modes, and so we are working on expanding our local oscillator spectrum. But then, one of the main limitations of what I've shown you is that when we make a measurement, we measure one mode. which means that we destroy all the others, and this is not what you want for measurement-based quantum computing. So what we have done already, I just didn't show you a result directly on that. So we did implement multi-pixel detection, so where you can measure all frequencies, well, in practice 16, at the same time, and have a direct measurement of 16 modes in your experiment. So in what we have done so far, quantum efficiency is not enough yet. So we are working on improving that. But then now it means that the basis we measure on is defined by this frequency basis. Well, you still have 2 degrees of freedom here. You have one, so when you make 16 measurements, you can still do by post-processing a basis change, so to adapt the mode basis you want. But the other one that we are implementing now is that we can do pulse shaping, so we can change the shape of the pump of the process. And if you change the pump of the process, you change the eigenmode of your system, and you can try to adapt to this multimode scenario. And in particular, so this we are doing a lot of work on that, and both at the theory level and the experimental level, how we can make a tomography of our multimode non-Gaussian states. And I recommend the 2 posters from Mattia and Ganel this afternoon. Then what we can do, and this I will be very quick because Valentina will speak about that, but you know what Ulrich had been presented, this time multiplexing way of generating a million of bins, so which was originally introduced by Akira Furosawa, but that also Ulrich is doing. But it turns out that in our case, in fact, if we do experiment without a cavity, the modes here can be single pulses, and it's quite easy, let's say, to extend what we do to this scenario. What is not easy is to do the single pulse experiment, and Valentina will speak about that. But once we have that, it's not hard to move to this time bin multiplexing, and thus to combine the time bin approach they developed with our multimode approach here. Well, finally, let me acknowledge, so this is a whole group, at least as far as the name are concerned. So this is all people in the group, so that includes all our activities, would it be in quantum metrology with spatial modes, quantum networks, and so on. In Italic are the people that left recently the group, and this is a picture that starts to date a little bit. I think it's close to 2 years old now, at least 1.5, where we could still gather together, and as everybody, you know that this is what looks like our group meeting right now. Hopefully this is soon over, and we will be able to do a meeting all together. But in the meantime, thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to answer any questions.